the state of the market out here is what?
Frothy.
Yeah?
Yeah, we'll play word association. Frothy. I just think, you know, late stage private valuations are quite high. And then you've seen a bunch of what you would consider previously growth investors, growth private equity investors, moving earlier and earlier to get away from that frothiness. And that's causing the seed stage now to be remarkably high valuations.
You see that same way, Jeff, or differently?
Yeah, I think the market, we had a 10-year bull run, and San Francisco is arguably the epicenter of the value creation in that bull run with tech. And even at big tech, Microsoft's at an all-time high, Google, Amazon, all these companies are running. They're also all employing tens of thousands of workers here. I think Facebook alone in the last 5 years has hired 40,000 people in the Bay Area. So the market's hot, not just from a valuation standpoint, but also just from an economic standpoint.
I wonder what we do with that as investors. You know, those of us who are sitting watching the program, who invest in these companies more so on the public side than obviously the private side. Whether you're supposed to sit back and wait for the air to come out of the balloon a little bit, or what do you think?
I mean, you know, not telling you anything that people don't say all the time, but trying to time these things is crazy. I've been looking at the public markets and thinking they were due for a bigger correction for quite some time, and they keep on proving themselves to be pretty resilient. So I don't know that you can do that. There's still a lot of great enterprise technology companies out there publicly that are doing quite well, and having great earnings reports like Twilio just did. So I don't know that that's a good idea to sit on the sidelines and wait.
What do you think about that, Jim?
Yeah, the thing I'd add there, Dick mentioned Twilio. I mean, there are a whole bunch of great private tech companies that are up and coming. I know we're going to talk about a few, but you look at companies, if you like Twilio, you're going to love Snowflake. Yeah. You're going to love HashiCorp. You're going to love Datadog. There's a whole crop of companies coming up, particularly on the enterprise side, that are really playing into the big macro trends that are happening around the globe. So I think sitting out that next wave of companies is probably the wrong call. I'm not a market timing guy. We invest pretty regularly every year. But there are some fantastic companies that are up and coming, you know, beyond the WeWorks and Airbnbs that everybody hears about.
This gives us kind of a unique opportunity coming back out here from, you know, being on the ground 6 months or so ago to see where we really are. You have a chance to look back at a scorecard, if you will.
Yep.
The companies that have gone public, the biggest ones of all, the Ubers and the Lyfts, haven't done as well as, say, the Zooms and some of the other names. What's the message in that? If anything.
I mean, I think Jeff just referred to it. These enterprise software companies that have great unit economics, almost an infinite total addressable market because more and more industries are becoming technology companies. So the all the folks we just talked about, Twilio and the like, can serve more and more industries and more companies in those industries. Those are going to be great companies, and the economics work, and they've got great growth. Some of the bigger names, the ones you just mentioned, Lyft and Uber and others, have yet to prove that the unit economics work. You know, when if you lose money on every ride,
right.
Dot,
it makes
dot,
it a
dot.
More difficult. I wonder, you know, if the Ubers and the Lyfts and some of those companies, Jeff, that were on the sidelines of the public markets for so long, and they got so big. That there was little money to be made for the public investor who came in. Private investors, you know, pushed these valuations so high to the moon that there was just public investors left holding the bag.
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly a different market than you had back in 1995 when Amazon went public at a $500 million market cap. So today you're seeing companies go out at 5, 10, 15, or in Uber's case, even higher, billion. But I think I go back to what Dick said. If you look at the enterprise space in particular, there's been a lot of money made in enterprise. If you're a public market investor and you made money in Shopify, you're up 20x from the IPO. If you're in Twilio, you're up, I think, 15x. If you're in, you know, there's a whole Zendesk, you're up 10x. Okta, you're way up.
MongoDB.
So there's a basket of 70 SaaS companies that have gone out since Salesforce went public. Those 70, on average, have returned almost 5x from their IPO price. So there's a ton of value in the market. It's just not always with the headline, late-stage, consumer-oriented tech companies.
Well, that's a good point. I mean, have we now made, is there a line now between the enterprise company and the consumer company? It's going to be much harder for the consumer-driven tech company to do well on the public stage, whereas there's all the hype about the business side, the enterprise side, the Zooms who are profitable, companies making money versus those that are not.
I just think on the consumer side, we're in this phase, I guess, where the companies coming out haven't proven the unit economics work, you know, for every incremental customer that we make a little more money, or and it's we make you know, even more money on every incremental customer. I think when Airbnb comes out, you know, that may change. I don't know all the details behind their financials, but Brian's run a pretty great company there. Everybody that I know inside the company, former Twitter employees, love it there. They seem to think the company's exciting and got a lot of room to run. So that'll be a fun one when that comes out.